Last evening we went into the question, are sense pleasures death traps? The pleasure drive, being so much part of us, day in and day out, confounds us, confuses us, and creates a whole lot of problems in relationships. Against that backdrop, we found that the pleasure drive cannot be isolated as something having to do only with the sense organs. It is rather a complex scenario involving a lot of psychological conditioning or programming, values, beliefs, and above all, mere habits in the mind empower the senses, and the senses in turn induce more and more conditioning on the plane of thoughts. Therefore, the gist of last night's talk was basically an appeal or a call for seeing the whole of the problem. It was a call for an awareness of all the components that go into making us what we are. Only in seeing the whole of the mind and going to the root of the issue, a true transformation can come about, and not otherwise. In the same setting where we are concerned with understanding how we act, how we react, how we experience fear or sorrow, this evening we consider the issue of time. Time presents itself before us as external time as well as internal time. There is the clock time. Everybody carries the wristwatch. Everyone has timepieces. An attractive timepiece is often a gift on a birthday or on an anniversary and whatnot. Very rarely one can give the gift of time itself to another. Time is measured outside, and there is a subjective measurement of time. We shall dwell briefly on the external time and then go into the internal time more for two reasons. The brevity of dwelling on external time is for two reasons. One is, in the matter of spiritual evolution, in the matter of our inner transformation, so that we may be free from all negative energy, we may live harmoniously, external time is not a player. Therefore, we shall not go into external time for much time. Second reason is, the speaker is not very well informed also about external time. Though I have always been fascinated by discoveries in science about the secrets of time, I somehow could not manage time so far to get a handle on this relativity of time. So briefly, we know time outside is now questioned in science, they say time is relative. Time outside is measured as the distance between two events. And what do we use to measure that distance between two events? For ordinary purposes, we have a whole range of clocks and timepieces, wristwatches and whatnot. But for very accurate measurement, we use the speed of light itself as the yardstick. So sensors or instruments that can catch the photons, the light particles, that are used to identify two events, give to us a measurement of time. Speed of light has been accepted as a constant, though there is a lot of questioning of properties of light these days. The idea that nothing can travel faster than light is questioned, as most of us know. People have proposed some particles which travel faster than light. However, in the Einsteinian model, using the speed of light, a whole lot of measurement, understanding, determination of the universe was made. And we know how the literature on the relativity of time touches on issues like measuring time when the observer herself is moving at a speed closer to that of light. Speed of light, we understand, is 186,000 miles per second. And if the observer, the experimenter, is herself traveling, imagine, at speeds closer to the speed of light, then we have all this talk of time slowing down or time speeding up, clock slowing down or clock rotating faster, depending on the direction of travel of the observer. We know very well that our picture of a star which is, let's say, 3 light years away is not at all the picture of the star as it is now. We take a photograph, and that picture of the star which is 3 light years away, light year being not a unit of time, though it's called light year, it being a unit of distance. The picture we take of a star 3 light years away is how it was 3 years ago. By the time light rays have come to our camera, the star out there might have changed, it might have become extinct also. So, in very long distances and in situations where very high speeds are involved, our idea of time changes drastically. So today, with respect to outer time, and so with respect to outer space, we have mind-blowing observations or remarks from the scientific community. Long back I heard this joke that an old lady sat next to Albert Einstein on a bench in a park. Soon after his name came in all the newspapers, by sheer chance, he thought nobody would disturb him, and he was on a bench, and this lady, old lady, also sat next to him. And then she said to him, "Looks like you are Albert Einstein, whose picture has come in the newspaper." And he says, "Yes, ma'am." And the lady says, "Now come on, tell me. I believe you have talked about relativity of time. What is it all about? I could not make head or tail of it when I read in the newspaper." And in this joke, Einstein says, "Look, ma'am, when you are sitting next to me, 5 minutes go like 1 hour. If a college girl from De Anza were to sit next to me, 1 hour will go like 5 minutes. That is all I said using complex mathematical equations." You and I can appreciate jokes at least, but to do justice to this theme of relativity of external time, a certain amount of exercise needs to be taken up. Not that it cannot be done, you just have to have time and sit down, and there are people of common interest, and sort it out. So, is this space regular space or curved space? Is time an absolute or relative to parameters of the observer, etc., are questions in science, which in a sense do have a bearing on the spiritual science. But in spiritual science, we can go about understanding time in a different way. We take a different approach. Interestingly, the word in Sanskrit for time has been kala. And kala has also been the word for death. And time often stands for death. In many Indian languages, it has been a practice to say when someone died, he became Kalavasha. Time took him away. Lord Shiva is called Kala Kala. He puts an end to time itself. He is called Antakantaka. He is one who kills Yama, who is the killer of all. A whole lot of Puranic symbolism has all along questioned time. Things like when Lord Shiva plays his damaru, that causes time. Some old classics say such things, and they have great poetic beauty. And they make us wonder. They stun us. In a sense, time stops for us when we come across sublime literature. We are stunned. We are awestruck. Watching the Grand Canyon or standing before the large masses of water coming down in the Niagara, you and I literally stop and we say, time stopped for us. For a while, time stopped. We say such things. Vimala Thakur, a great thinker on spiritual themes, says, meditation is meeting eternity in the present moment. In the present moment, if all time shrinks, so to say, in the sense, ordinarily we perceive past and future. We not only perceive, but past and future seem to hold us in their grip. Our anxiety about what might happen tomorrow, and our regrets about what happened yesterday are so palpable, so tangible, and we are thus caught in the net of time. But in meditation, Vimala says, we meet eternity in the present moment. There is no pressure, there is no disturbance by past or future. Without interpreting this as erasure of thoughts or absence of thoughts, we would say, thoughts or no thoughts, figures or no figures, images or no images, the sense of I is free from pressure. All of us carry a sense of I. Tomorrow we shall be taking up who am I, and we shall go into different dimensions of what this I is about. We carry a sense of I, and thoughts build this sense of I. And if this sense of I disappears into thin air, then no matter what images, pictures, memories or thoughts about future might be suspended in the space of our awareness, there is an eternity caught in the present moment. As you and I are here dwelling on, can we conquer time? All the clocks, all the wristwatches, the wristwatch on the wrist of the speaker included, are ticking away ruthlessly, shamelessly, with great glee. They tick away. That is external time. But internally, we experience time. Swami Tejomayananji jokes in a pravachan, for some people, time drags so slowly. Again and again they see the clock or the watch. What? It's not yet. 90 minutes are not over yet. And he says, some people check whether the clock is running or not. Whereas some others, at the end of the 90-minute session, are shocked. What? It's over? So soon? Externally, it is the same 90 minutes. But internally, for someone, it was like ages. They may compliment the speaker also. It felt like you spoke for ages today. Or they may say to the speaker, oh, we don't know how it all went, you know, so soon it's over. My God, they may express in a very different way. In the Bhagavad Gita, the 8th chapter, you have Lord Krishna saying some queer things. I have not understood it really. But it always, you know, touches us. It fills us with wonder. He says in the 17th verse of the chapter 8, Sahasrayuga paryantam aharyat brahmano viduhu ratrim yuga sahasrantam teho ratra vido janah. The knowers of the secrets of time, those who know the inner truth of day and night, know that one day of the Creator, Brahma, equals thousands of millions of years of human time. In the same way, one night of the Creator, Brahma, equals thousands of millions of human days and nights. So two axes of time. You and I can, to an extent, appreciate how when we dream, and in the dream we perceive 6 hours we played golf, and then we wake up and find that it was just an afternoon nap for 10 minutes. So the waking life's 10 minutes and the dream's 6 hours, as though were two axes of time. And therefore in these spiritual classics, with mythology and symbolism and a whole lot of other things packed into one, possibly the whole creation in which you and I are players, are characters, is looked at as the dream of the Creator. When you dream, you create a golf ground, and you play golf for 6 hours, 18 holes completed exactly at the end of the sixth hour. Wow, good score. Tiger Woods is not far. I'm getting close. You pat yourself on the back. In your dream, you created the space of the golf grounds and the 6 hours of time. And when you wake up, in your waking world, all that passed was 10 minutes. Could it be that there is the mind of God which dreams? And in the dream that the mind of God dreams, you and I are living, and thousands of years pass in this dream of God's mind. And if God has his own waking axis of time, these thousands and millions of years are only one day in his waking state, God's waking state. That is how even movies like Matrix, etc., have played with these concepts of one domain of X, Y, Z and T, and then a virtual world where another set of X, Y, Z and T are created, and in some mysterious way these heroes and villains and heroines, etc., are able to go into that virtual world, and then all they need is a public booth to get back quickly. Telephone booth, and key in some number, and boom, they are back to this Brahma's world and human world. Two worlds, two sets of X, Y, Z, the space coordinates, and T, the time. So, come back to internal time. And we need to get into it. As I said, spiritually this is very important. We have thoughts. Rather than distance between two events, here we consider the distance between two concepts. Psychological, that is inner time, is the distance between one concept of who I am and a second concept, neither of them is reality, of who I want to be. So I have a picture of who I am, very questionable indeed, but I judge myself on a given day, at a given point of time, I judge myself as, let us say, very well-to-do. I have made good money. In 3 generations in my family, no one did so much as I have done. Something like that. That is one self-judgment in a favorable light, but not as favorable as I would want to have. there is in my mind another picture of what I want to be. I am a millionaire, but stop not till the goal is reached. My goal is to be a billionaire. M needs to be replaced by B. So, one self-judgment, then there is the other self-judgment, and there is the becoming. Will I become? Will I succeed? And in this mental movement of wanting to become, there is hope, there is desire, there is fear. And we experience an inner time. Materially and in the so-called religious context, we want to become something. Psychological time rises the moment you have a picture of having to become. I want to become like Vivekananda. I want to become a realized soul. God knows what it means. But I want to become an enlightened soul. I want to become a mukta. I was baddha yesterday. I am mumukshu today. And I want to be mukta tomorrow. Some ideas. Will I? Or will my wife get there before I do? That will be one more victory for her, I tell you. Suppose I am worried. See, I am describing fear, hope, desire, apprehension. And the whole lot comes. Husband, wife, neighbor, who joined a particular spiritual organization first. How many books I studied, he studied, they studied. And who is senior? Who got the orange clothes first? You put two swamis on the stage and somebody and me, let us say, and if I have thoughts, he is older in age, but I received sannyas before he did. This is called the field of becoming, where we place ourselves here, place somebody else there. Now, in this mental movement, what happens is, we create another set of coordinates of becoming, reaching somewhere, arriving, etc. And in the process, we create time. We have built the psychological time. And in the process, we do not see the whole of the mind as it is. We have as though entered the virtual world of the mind and have become a player there. When you buy in to a self-judgment, you become that character in the play for which you wrote the script. You are the director, you are the producer, but alas, you forgot that it's a play. You become the hero. Suffering or enjoying, getting promoted or getting demoted. And what a great unfolding of scenes after scenes. You and I are doing this every moment. Can we suspect the whole of our mind? Can we look at the whole mind as this entire thing needs to be seen again, reviewed? Generally we say, one of these days I will do it. We are in the grip of time, and no wonder, time is death. Leave alone the clinical death at the age of 70 or 100, 60 or 90. There is the clinical death of any of us. But there is the other death. about which Upanishads are very concerned, and from which Upanishads wish to free us. When the Upanishads say Amritatva, immortality, obviously they are not talking of freeing us from the clinical death. The body dies. Then what is immortality? It is freeing us from this field of becoming. I am at peace with what I am, which doesn't mean I become irresponsible. That's a hasty conclusion. Don't jump to that conclusion. I am in terms with the present moment, whatever I am, advanced or lagging behind, rich or poor. I don't create a judgment, then create another judgment of what I want to be, and then draw the lines of something like draw the railway lines, railway track, and run the motor, or run this train of the self, which is one more imagined thing, on those tracks. Rather, I stay silent deep within me. The core of me is silent. I may be seeing, I may be drinking, I may be eating, I may be receiving something, giving. And there are thoughts, there is planning, there is remembering something. But as the mind is into all this, think of it, if there is a certain silence and grasping of the whole, then I am not touched by time. Time is a parameter in this whole, but I am touching the whole. If I become a player in this scenario, I am caught by time. Like in a video game, Nintendo, etc., there is a character on the screen, and that fellow is in trouble because another character is chasing him. And unless something is done, this second character will smash this first character. So you may try to save this first character. And if you identify with this first character on the screen, you also get very panicky. What will happen now? Otherwise, you are very safe. So, in the mind, a Nintendo goes on, and we are identifying with this I. What is the true I? So, not the clinical death, but this creation of our thoughts, time created by thoughts, by putting pressure and once in a while raising hope, but most of the time giving us this undesired gift of anxiety, is killing us slowly. They say diabetes is a slow killer. When 2 years ago, I went for a routine checkup in Hinduja Hospital in Bombay, student in the class was behind me, you should have a checkup. I said, okay. So one morning we went, and all sorts of checkups. And when we drove back in a car, back to the ashram in Bombay, Dr. Ajit asked me, how did you feel about all the tests? I said, I liked the breakfast very much. Because early morning we were there, and certain tests were conducted in fasting, and blood sugar, blood was taken. Then they gave a sumptuous breakfast. And we have been trained to joke. So I said, breakfast was wonderful. And I said, all that was very nice, good. I learnt a lot about modern medical equipment. And next day when the report came, they said, you have 450 in blood sugar and all that. Then of course, now I have marginal. And a couple of months later, when I gave some discourses in Muscat, I remember one of the ladies somehow found out I am diabetic. And she said, Swamiji, sorry to tell you, this is a slow killer. Sorry to tell you. three times. Today I would say that more than diabetes, the psychological time is a slow and more deadly killer. One of the one-act plays in English, I don't remember its name, has the famous saying, "The brave die but once, the cowardly die again and again and again." Every day they die 20 times. In every compromise, in every pretending, in every anxious moment, every time they tell a lie, they put up a facade, there is a slow dying. Where are they alive? The cowardly are not alive. They are dying. The brave die but once. So against this, talking about this inner dying, shrinking, this inner undesirable way of living that you and I have, no wonder Lord Sri Krishna declares in the Bhagavad Gita, that kalosmi lokakshayakrit pravriddaha, I am time, in the 11th chapter, 32nd verse, I am time and I am all set to destroy this whole universe. Kalosmi lokakshayakrit pravriddaha, lokan samahartumiha pravrittaha, rute pitva na bhavishyanti sarve, yevastita pratyanikeshu yodhah. Arjuna, you think that it depends on you whether this war will take place or not, whether all these folks will die or not. You are mistaken. Rute pitva, even without you, all those who have to die will die. For I have set it in motion. I am the great destroyer. I am time. And in 10th chapter, he describes himself as time in a bit of a different context. In 30th verse of chapter 10, Kala kalayatamaham. In all matters of counting, today we have calculators. Long back, was it Abacus? Let us say there was a slide rule. There were, of course, so many tables, so many ways, and you have Vedic mathematics also, though it's a misnomer. You have ways of counting. And Sri Krishna says, among all systems of counting, or why, among all who count, I am the greatest counter. And what is that aspect of you that counts? Time. Kala kalayatamaham. I am time among those who count, he says. And I would attach special inner importance to it, because this mental movement where we perceive ourselves based on only limited information, based on some value system, we perceive ourselves as so and so, and then we have a picture of wanting to become so and so, and between these two so and so's there is a counting. Will I become that in 3 days? Will I become that in 3 years? And in religion, in religious inquiry also, most people are unable to put aside the thought, will I be free in this life? Please tell me, they ask sometimes, they pester gurus. One student of mine long ago was behind me in the western Himalayas, Siddhabari. We have a beautiful ashram. This evening, 92 or so, I was walking, and this student follows me. She has some concept of herself, and she has a very false concept of me as an enlightened soul, which I am not even today. 92, you don't know the amount of confusions I had, but I won't make it a confession session here. So she is coming after me, Swamiji, please be kind to me. You are enlightened, you can see three periods of time. And tell me, just, I won't ask you any other question. Will I be enlightened in this life? I said, how do I know? First, you allow me to be enlightened. But she said, you are humble. You are good-humored. You are not admitting. Terrible prarabdha. Never envy a Swami. You don't know the professional hazards that Swamis have. So coming back to the serious point, the thought, will I be enlightened before I am 60, before I am 80, or at least in this life, without waiting for next life, is a counting. And the Lord is present. He is the creator of the whole universe. Our world is His dream, we said before. In the light of all this, and going again a bit deeper into how we are caught in psychological time, we may see this, that the medium of thoughts brings the illusion of time, that is clear, and the illusion of time sits heavily upon us when there is the ego, the self. If our involvement as a part of the whole scenario is put aside, we are the witness. I am not a part of the scene, but I am the quiet, uninvolved witness of the whole of the mind. Then even though there may be thoughts, there may be movement, there may be an emerging of various scenes and scenarios, one who pays attention to the whole of the mind will not feel the pressure of time, will not feel being driven by time, dragged by time, pulled and pushed by time. When you have that inner stillness, when you have that absence of the disease of wanting to become something, when you are handling this moment as though it is the only moment, you are giving your best to this moment, you are eating, let us say, a breakfast, and you are savoring the breakfast fully. All your taste buds are fully savoring. Spirituality is about it. When you know eating your breakfast with full attention, there is great spirituality there. Eat when you eat, work when you work, sleep when you sleep, take bath when you are taking bath, etc., are one well-known description of spiritual maturity. When I am taking bath, I think of breakfast, and when I am before my breakfast, I think of work at office, and during work at office, I think, what the breakfast was? Did I eat at all in the first place? This is considered a really, disorderly way of living. And spirituality is basically orderly living. When life has order, not according to some formula of this system or that system, not according to those, rules. And orderly life means 4 o'clock one has to get up, is it not? Getting up at 4 has its value, fine, but certainly it is not to be equated to orderly life. This is a system, that is a cultural thing, that is a particular packaging. Orderly life is not at all in these external issues. It is absence of self-created conflict. It is coming to terms with what life has brought you to. If I have some sickness, I perceive all that sickness brings to me, I am aware and awake and sensitive to every ounce of pain that sickness brings to me, whether it is a blockage of nose, a little cough and cold, or some serious other disease. One is totally aware and one is sensitive, and in that meeting with what is, there is order. In escaping from what is through a generation of a lot of associated thoughts, why did I get this disease at this age of 42? It could have come at 46. Why didn't my neighbor get this? Why did I alone? He deserves it more definitely. Suppose these are called, various unnecessary thoughts. I told my neighbor so many times, even now he doesn't care to get up at 4 o'clock. But I am getting up at 4. This comparison is disorder. This comparison makes me live in a split personality. The neighbor snoring away at that hour is at least, in a sense, in great order. He is asleep and he is not comparing his sleep with my meditation, and he has come to terms with his sleep. I mean, in sleep, what else do we have? No choice. When we are snoring away, then we have no conflict. Some of us have later on, how much I slept. And being a Swami, can I sleep so much at all? Another professional hazard of Swamis. I should not tell you too many of my problems. So, the self, small s, I'm not talking of the transcendental self with capital S, the self, the ego, aham vritti, the thought, I am this, I am that, is so integral, so vital to the creation of this psychological time. When you create a concept of you are this and you are that, and give reality to it, breathe life into it, which you do in such artistic ways, you cannot escape the illusion of becoming. Whereas, in total attention, what Vedanta calls Sakshi Bhava, witnesshood, which big books talk about, no doubt, but a lot of common people live it, and it's not really necessary to read big books to live this. To live this life, a life of real integration, it's not the books, but it is, divine grace. It is an insight, and God knows how that insight comes to X or Y. How someone like Ramana Maharshi at the young age of 17, when all believed he was just ordinary like anyone else, gets a fear of death and then decides to watch that entire business called dying, instead of crying for help, instead of escaping from it, instead of bringing some third factor, fourth factor to it. He rather does, I would put it this way, he rather takes the fear of death and says, I have this fear, and today I tend to think that rather than going for third factor, fourth factor, shall I call my aunt or shall I run downstairs? These are the other things. From two factors, the fear of death and me, he arrives at one factor alone, that is fear alone. Me, what is this me? Tomorrow also we shall go into it in great detail. Psychologically, when I have fear of death, the me is in terms of, I was healthy up to yesterday, today what is happening to me? A description of oneself. I am only 17. Why this chest pain or why this fear of death? Why my whole body is trembling? If it was trembling, I don't know. Again, you described yourself in some way. So, suppose you watch fear, you go through fear with no thought of your identity. Not even thinking, I am a man and I have this fear. Or I am a woman and I have this fear. That is description. This morning only I had told somebody that I have, by God's grace, wonderful health and this is happening to me now at 11 a.m. This is a description. In pure attention, there is no room for all this description. No one has asked you and there is no business to give some story. In pure attention, which is a simple affair and yet slips through our fingers, here is fear and I don't describe myself in any way. And in a moment of not describing myself in any way, there is no me. There is only fear. And in there being only fear, a transformation takes place. That is how Ramana later said, I watched my dying, the body became cold, blood circulation stopped, breathing stopped. I watched all this non-verbally, he says. I watched all this without a single word in Tamil or English passing through me. Perhaps he knew two languages at that time. Not a single word in his mother tongue, or he had learnt some English at the school. Some Telugu and Malayalam also he knew, it seems. No word arose. Non-verbally, I watched. And this is a great mystery. I would imagine that there was being with fear with no thinking. And no dullness, please. If you see a serpent, you see the serpent with no thought, but not dull. You are not dull. If you were dull, you would not see the snake properly. Can you see the snake? And let us say the snake raises its hood, it expands its hood, and there are some details, and you have fear in you. Now you watch the snake. You watch whatever is at that time. Not adding spice to it, not giving a commentary. Then something can happen. That moment of fear can be a moment of radical transformation in you. Then time which kills you is killed. You kill time. There's no you really. The awareness kills time. I believe in this country you have an expression, doing time, which means I learned this morning only. It is really well said, and some of the American expressions have intentionally or unintentionally a great spiritual depth in them. Here I would give it to that. For doing time, serving a prison term, yes, when we do time, in the sense I am talking, that we bring time, we create time in thoughts, we create the psychological time in the medium of desire and hope, fear and anxiety, then we are in fact like prisoners. And enlightened beings undo time. They set themselves free. It is said two great souls, both of whom we believe were enlightened, Anandamayima and Papa Ramdas, were going once in a car to attend a certain function. Very rarely two Mahatmas of that order get together, but this was one occasion. And halfway through the journey, Papa Ramdas looked at his wristwatch, and Anandamayima nudged him and teased him. Oh, I didn't know Papa is in time. I thought you have transcended time. That's what she meant. And Ramdas jovially replied, as somebody else in the car puts it in his memoir, Ramdas jovially said, "Oh no, Papa is both in time and beyond time." And the journey continues. No issue, no conflict. So what is it to be in time as well as beyond time? Functional clock time always is in our life. It is part of life. But psychological time is our own creation. Sri Ramana talks about time in his Saddarshanam. First of all, he says, our problem is we have taken the present moment for granted. In one of the two shlokas which dwell on the mystery of time in Saddarshanam, which was originally Ulladu Napat, he says, Bhutam bhavishyaccha bhavat svakale tadvartamanasya vihaya tattvam hasyana kimsyad gatabhavicharcha vinaika sankhyam ganane valoke. Is it not ridiculous, he asks in this verse, to try to understand future and past without having total attention in the present, without understanding the present? It would be ridiculous indeed to go into future and past without understanding the present, very much like without knowing number one, one is counting. One does not count one. You give to somebody a box of, let's say, marbles, and he starts counting 7, 8, 9, 10, etc. You wonder. Or I believe someone was counting a pad of currency notes. The other man had asked this person, please check if there are 100 rupee notes here. And this person went loudly, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 87, 88, 89, 91, up to there he went. And then he put the pad aside and said, it is all right. And the other man said, I didn't hear you going up to 100. You stopped a few, bills before it ended. This man said, no, up to 91 it was all right. It should be all right after that. Up to 91 I found it all right. So it will be all right up to 100. This is very silly. Hasyaspadam. Hasyana kim syat gatabhavi charcha vina ekasankhyam gananeva loke. These are all quite profound things, and I may perhaps ask the right questions here. Can you and I understand the present moment in its whole? Like our issue yesterday of desire, which at first sight is a simple affair which has to be controlled or which has to be okayed depending on whether it meets the requirement. Go by some value system, go by some charts, and then make a classification. These are good desires in me, these are bad desires in me. What is the big deal? Why should we make it so intellectual? Just indulge in the good desires and just put your foot down and control yourself in the bad desires, period. I think people like Chidananda, take simple things and make it very complicated. One may say so. But those who listen with more attention see the truth of what we said yesterday. Desire is not so simple that you classify and then take a decision. It won't work. With all respect for those sources of guidance, which are true also. Some desire, let us say, is all set to destroy you, and some other desire is really good and it is for good of others and for you. But to presume that you can stop the wrong desire and go ahead with right desire in a very simple way is rather childish. So, just like that, here too, you and I wonder, this present moment, what is there to know about the present moment? Vartamanasya tattvam vihaya bhuta bhavishyat charcha hasyaspada hasyana kim says Ramana. And you, Vartamana, this moment? It's okay. No, that's not the question. Right now, in this moment, right in my mind, I have a summary of the entire suffering of my life. My suffering of my life is in a nutshell contained in the present moment. To break this nut, the nutshell or whatever, to break this present moment is to put my whole life in order. This is the mystery there. Again, in another verse, Sri Ramana says, while the first one, I hope everyone saw the thrust there is an intense appeal for understanding the present moment in its entirety. Outside, inside, so many factors make me desire some things. If I am desiring at this moment, if I am fearing, whatever be the fear, if I am fearing at this moment of fear in me has a lot of factors in it. And generally we see the tip of the iceberg and we are in a panic. In fact, it is rightly said that fear is not so much the problem, but fear about the fear. Oh, yo, I have again fear, what shall I do? You know, fear, then I am afraid of fear. Again I am afraid, can you tell me a quick way to undo this fear? So fear and then fear about fear or panic about fear. So undoing it, if we meet with fear, there is a different dimension. That is meeting the present moment. And when we meet the present moment, being fully present, available to the present moment, then we have a chance to meet eternity in present moment. In the second verse of the Saddarshanam, Sri Maharshi asks, Kvabhati dikkala vina kathasman dikkala lileha vapurvayam chet na kvapi bhamo na kadapi bhamo vayam tu sarvatra sadacha bhamaha. This verse means our entire grasp of psychological time. Incidentally, the verse touches on space also, but let me highlight time because of shortage of time. Our entire perception of psychological time, at this rate, where am I heading, where is my family heading, and all those, you know, psychological time. This entire scenario of psychological time rests on, he says, Vapur vayam chet, rests on our belief that we are the body. Literally it means body consciousness. But I would slightly elaborate it, saying the entire scenario of our being subject to psychological time rests on our notion that we are successful or we are a failure, we are handsome or we are not good looking, a judgment. If there is no self-judgment, not by deciding not to have one, but by being gently aware, as other day I said, perhaps I said, to have a sip of water, do I need to know I am Swami Chidananda? To have a sip of water, do I need to know I am 46 years old? I need not have a third sip now. The illustration is, for hundreds of things, for a lot of things in daily life, there is no need really for me to put myself in a pigeonhole. I am so and so, my name is this, and I am from India, and who is asking? But we tend to carry these thoughts, and in some strange way, and everyone has to sort out for oneself. I am sure everybody says, but is it not necessary to plan, to go? And I admit, it's necessary to plan. But for 1 ounce of planning, we do hundreds and hundreds of pounds of, going into the future. So for things to fall in place, there needs to be a discernment, a viveka, discerning. And there needs to be a childlike simplicity to us which doesn't collide with our skills and talents and professional abilities and knowledge of languages and places and people. You and I, as we grow up, has a whole lot of knowledge. And in the light of that knowledge, we have a certain identity, agreed. So this identity and the knowledge and the use of that knowledge do not have to collide with a childlike simplicity. In the childlike simplicity, one lives in gentle awareness, and at the right time one uses an identity and plans and goes ahead. At the right time one uses the right identity. Somebody at some airport, some public place, at a counter, when a lot of people are waiting for their name to be called, let us say, I am there among them, and they call, Chidananda, then it warrants my responding, I am Swami Chidananda, they called my name, yes, and I go present myself at the counter, right? In contrast, to sip a bit of water, there is no recall needed. So, in gentle awareness, things fall into places. The identity of our being this or that, our being a householder or a sannyasi, our being father of three children or mother of two, etc., rises at the right time, does not raise its head at other times. Then, Maharshi Ramana would say, this deha buddhi, I am this, sits aside, and then there is no psychological time. One lives with a touch of eternity. One lives with a great depth, with a great profoundness, not the depth or breadth of the scholar, not of information, but the depth, the profoundness of that being, simple being. So Sri Maharshi seems to point to that when he says, second half of the shloka, Vayam tu sarvatra sadacha bhamaha. When this I thought, when this ego, when this self, painted favorably one morning and painted rather unfavorably on many other occasions, is out of the scenario, thoughts do not make a picture of me. When we drink water without a single thought of who we are, then Vayam tu sarvatra sadacha bhamaha. Do we have any spatial limitation at all in our experience wise? The sense of I has no boundary then. And do we have psychologically any boundary in time for the sense of I? thoughts create the boundary. And meeting eternity in the present moment is being free from the mischief of thoughts. Time stands still, poets say, right? What is it after all? It is absolutely not stopping of all the clocks. All clocks, you know, suddenly stopped. Or sometimes there are some dramatic picturization which delight children especially. When the Lord decides, the rising waves stop for a moment. The waving trees stop for a moment. Everything halts for a moment. In movies they show. And we say, could it happen? It is said a great lady, was it Anasuya, said to the sun, don't set this evening. And the sun stopped. Today's physics students may say, hey, that must have been worked out. The earth stopped rotating. We are very curious to give an explanation how it... Okay, earth stopped rotating. And you and I are very thrilled in the beginning with this kind of physical stoppage. But the poets and mystics are not at all talking about the physical stoppage of clocks or waves or sun, moon and any object. You are driving at 70 miles per hour on the freeway and without making that 70 miles, even 69, without slowing down in terms of car speed, your anxieties can come down, your fears can come down in a perception, in an appreciation of truth. Your thoughts can slow down without making you dull once more. Unnecessary thoughts come down. And going at the same 70 miles and fully aware of the traffic scenario, you could meet eternity in the present moment. Your heart could be immersed in an indescribable love. No regret, no fear. You are ready to live, you are ready to die, you are ready to meet life as life comes to you without any thought about it. And you drive on, live on.